Council. We have our study session this evening. It's May 25th, 2015. Thank you all. Two agenda items for this evening.
Pretty close to May 26th.
It's May 26th. I've been corrected. So two agenda items tonight. One, as we've seen, is these are two discussions. One is with regard the potential for charter amendments to be considered on the ballot this November. And this is taking a look at what we should consider before we send the city attorney off to actually word the particular ballot items. So this is not a wording of those, but this is more of a frame. If we have any questions or thoughts, and I'll turn it over to the city manager when that comes. And then second item is with regard tobacco smoking in public, and Councilmember Brinkman will lead that discussion. And it's taking a look at what we might want to be doing as far as possibly changing some regulations within the city. So those are the agenda items for this evening. And so with the first, I'm going to turn it over. This will be our primary review discussion. The redlining was done to put it somewhat in context for folks. It was included in your package for this evening. And so, but this will be our primary discussion item. Just looking at the items here. The attorney, anything? Okay. City manager, your agenda.
Great.
Or you've got the stick.
My meeting. Thank you, Mayor. A little background before we get into the policy discussion this evening. I wanted to remind Council on the Charter Commission. Kristen, can you grab the door? The Council approved the Charter Review Committee on July 30th, 2013. You each appointed two members, so we ended up with 14 members on that group. That group met for 13 meetings between September of 2013 and May of 2014. Primary staff people on that were Wendy Hefner, city clerk, Kristen, city attorney, and myself. And then we had folks like Doug Farman and other key staff come in to give specific details on the charter items that were there. We also had bond counsel as part of the financial side of that conversation. And so it was pretty well vetted. The Charter Review Committee spent a lot of time debating the issues. You guys appointed a great cross-section of the community. There was definitely a heated conversation at times and fun conversation. So there are recommendations that came forward to you. We're virtually unanimous. There's a couple items this evening. I'll point out two of them specifically where we had a dissenting opinion, and the discussion amongst the Charter Review Committee was that the number of dissensions wasn't relevant, just that there was at least one person who thought that something should be different. The Council at a study session several months ago went through the Charter Review Committee recommendations, and we got up to paragraph 60 before we ran out of time that evening. And so just as a reminder, the Council did support everything moving forward that we have proposed to you this evening up until 60, again, paragraph 60 that you guys have reviewed. So on the document that we passed out, there is several columns on here. We have topic, sample ballot question, and the charter section. And what we're going to be... Let me back up. In order to have the conversation about what the ballot would look like, I asked Kristen to look at how we would package these together. We tried to find items that were basically non-controversial, things that were in service of the community, that the Charter Review Committee were unanimously in support of, and the ones at least that you guys had talked about that you guys supported as well. And so there was a lot of the work that Kristen had to do was to look at how we could merge these questions together to minimize the number of questions. And you can see we still ended up with a proposal of 30 questions this evening before you. And so what we are proposing is that all 30 of these questions be moved forward for November ballot. All but two of the ones before you were unanimously supported by the commission, and then again up to paragraph 60 were unanimously supported by this council during your study session several months ago. So I would propose that we certainly talk about the two items that did not have universal support by the commission, the Charter Review Commission, and then take any questions that you've got on any other sections rather than going one by one by one. I think since you guys have already reviewed up to number 60, it's probably not worth reviewing and starting over number one again. So I would propose we start with number 5, which is elections and voting, and that was one of the two that we had a dissenting opinion from the Charter Review Commission. Does that sound good?
Sounds good.
All right. So on Section 5, and the corresponding document is the redline version of what the Charter Review Commission had recommended for language. So on Section 5, we're going to be looking at Charter Section 16. And the issue on this one was the method of voting. So the dissenting vote on the Charter Review Committee was that the Election Commission should retain the right to choose the method of voting, and the majority of the commission thought that the council should make the decision around the method of voting. So we are recommending that you ask the voters to change it so that the city council has authority for making the decision for the method of voting. Questions?
Seeing none, I think you can move on.
Okay.
I do have a question.
Okay.
I was just kind of thinking about what, I was trying to remember what my question was going to be and write it down. So this will be for any election other than we would control all, the city council would control all elections?
No.
The scheduling and, I mean, no. It's really you that does it.
No,
right?
It's just the method of voting and Wendy can.
It is just the method of voting. My opinion as the city clerk is that I don't believe that two people in the city clerk should decide the method of voting for 43,000, a population of 43,000. I think that should be the elected officials that do that. And so right now, they could change the method of voting. It could be ranked voting, which is a type of voting. It could be approval voting, which is another type of voting. And then there is the standard, which is in the Colorado Revised Statutes. And that's what all now use is the standard voting. There are guidelines for ranked voting in the CRS, and Aspen was the only one that tried it, and it failed very miserably there. And we have been brought forward to the Election Commission at least twice, approval voting, and it failed 2-1. But I do not believe that, first off, the city clerk should not be deciding the method of voting. I think that's wrong. We're just the runners of it. You know, we just do the election. And so I don't think that we should be part of that. I think that the elected body is the ones that should decide what method of voting that the city, because you are the elected body, what method that the city should use.
And I guess I would add that there's two components to this. Question 3 increases. So there was some conversation about elimination of the Election Commission. However, we're not recommending that you move forward with that request to the voters, but at least that you increase the number of election commissioners from 3 to 5. And then subsequent to that, you change their authority and you ask the voters to shift the decision from the Election Commission to the City Council. And one thing, and I realize that this should be self-evident, but just to put it on the table, what we're asking and recommending here comes from your Charter Review Committee to ask the voters to do it. So this is purely a question of to the voters. So when you're thinking about whether you want to support that or not, the question is this worth asking the voters to say yay or nay to? Peggy, did you have a question?
Yeah, so... Is this working?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So the city clerk is a non-voting member.
Right now, I'm a voting member.
And so what's the status of item 3? Are we...
The city clerk would be a non-voting member, and there would be five appointed.
Are we saying to put that onto the ballot, right?
Yeah, we're recommending both.
Okay, so if the city clerk is not a voting member, if that passes, that doesn't compromise you in any kind of way, and it just has the voting members of the election commission deciding, and it seems to me council should not be doing the deciding. That's just my view. I think that's why we have an election commission.
Well, the question here, and this is what came out of our commission, is a recommendation to put it to the voters.
Right.
To take that. So
right.
You can have a personal opinion on that. The question is whether we take it to the voters.
Right, but that's what I didn't articulate that well. I think it should go to the voters to decide.
Right.
Okay? So I put it as a question to them.
Right. Okay. And so that's what this
is. That's what
that
is. Okay. Right.
Well, so that since I'm not hearing other people say yay, nay, whatever,
okay.
I'm trying to state an opinion.
Okay. Good.
So folks are good with five?
Yes.
Asking the voters. All right. 6, 7, 8, 9. I would stop at the next one actually is 15 that I would stop at. Questions between 6 and 14. Yes.
Just for amplification of the issue. The folks that put the charter together originally, it seems to me, wanted to have like an advise and consent kind of role for council. When the manager made a selection of the finance director and the clerk, is that who? Yeah.
Number seven.
Number seven,
yep.
The clerk.
Yep.
That it would be like an advise and consent role. The council wasn't going to do the selections and wasn't going to try to do any of the work, but just kind of had a stamp of approval at the end. There must have been a value to that. I don't have an emotional feeling one way or the other. I want to put this to the voters, but I'm wondering if there's discussion maybe.
Yeah, and I think the discussion around this one was that obviously we operate in a council manager form of government, and the committee felt that there was no reason since it clearly states the manager is CEO and handles administration, there was no definitive reason by which these two particular positions in this day and age, if you will, were called out for that advise and consent type of role. And so they're recommending that just like all the other positions in the city, it's handled by administration.
Thank you.
So that's why.
Thank you.
And that was a unanimous recommendation. And the council had supported that one previously as well.
Yeah.
But yes.
Yeah.
Good question. Yes, sir.
Talk to me a little bit about number 11.
So there was concern from the commission relative to the Denver water rights sale, and that the magnitude of that sale and the value of those water rights were such that the commission thought that something of that size and magnitude should have the voters approve it and not just the elected body of the council.
Are there, where we're at this juncture, certainly the open space property, the only water rights, we've got pretty much minimal water rights at this
correct.
Juncture, if I understand it correctly.
That is correct.
I guess I would not be in favor of this in particular by virtue of the fact that it is a slippery slope. We're either elected to represent the community to make complicated decisions, and that was a complex decision. At the time, it had a pretty hefty financial contribution to the community, and when we looked at it in detail, the future value of the water rights, you can say they were valuable, but when you looked at the opportunity to use them, they really weren't. And so trying to communicate that in an election broadly seems to me to be counterproductive.
Are you speaking specifically to the water right component or the open space edition?
To me, it's a slippery slope. I mean, we're either responsible for this stuff as representative democracy or you know, if we want to start going down this path, I mean, we've sort of had some of these conversations before. I mean, we can put everything to the voters. But then what's the point of sitting here? You know, if we're elected to do the job, we should do the job. And if people don't like the job we do, they should vote us out. But I'm not particularly in favor of starting to carve up contracts and said, well, this is an important contract, so the voters should say. And this is an important contract, so we should have an election on it. So I think we're eminently qualified to address those particular issues that are laid out in this question. And I don't see advantages to trying to put more and more stuff in front of the voters for direct election.
Okay. Before I turn this back to the mayor for running around the table, I think the open space piece, one of the things we had done was give the commission other charters to look at, and it is fairly common to have open space go, disposition of open space go to the voters, and the others can jump in here, but I think the water right piece was a reaction to that previous piece. So there may, just in terms of thinking about it, I think there were two different perspectives on this. One was common terminology in charters, and the other was that kind of, hey, we feel like we were slighted type of thing. But I do understand that they both fall into that category of representative versus direct democracy.
I'll just make, you know, my one observation on this, which is we already have constricted contractual elements in a very similar space. And so where the Charter Commission went was trying to put everything in the same bucket. And those are, when we're talking about parks and trails, we have this constraint. We can't dispose of a park. And there's probably a pretty gray area between what's a park and what's open space. And so they kind of put those in by this method, they're putting those in the same bucket. I could see water rights maybe being treated differently, but this was the recommendation of that came out of the commission.
I guess my understanding also was, though, from a practical standpoint, if we're using open space money to pay for open space acquisitions, we're constrained anyway. So, I mean, if
you'd have to refund it from the general fund.
So, I mean, from a practical perspective, this really smells like a solution in search of a problem. I don't see us doing any of that, and I don't see us coming up with the mass quantities of dollars it would take to refund it. Take a parcel out of open space and try to develop it. And I think if we did, it'd be a massive brouhaha. So I understand what you're saying. I respect your point.
And the question is, we may have minority opinions among this group,
right,
on these items. This is what came out of the Charter Commission, and their suggestion is to take these items to the voters. So, you know, the question that we would have is, the input that you have from actually those folks that you helped appoint to the Charter Commission were part of that unanimous position. And absent some of that, I kind of lean towards this, but before we ask our city attorney to run off and spend 20 hours or so in trying to, like how I throw around the amount of time, 20 hours or more trying to wordsmith ballot language. It was just trying to see that. And so I'll just kind of go around and see if there's sentiment around the table to exclude this from the list or not. I'm not looking for a vote. I'm just saying, you know, is there anyone else on?
I think it should be included for reasons you've expressed, and just that there's two different issues, it seems. But on the open space, I think that wording just needs to be in there. It's a new word. Park was the old word. I think it's just appropriate to update it there. And I understand the circumstance with the water, and I support putting it in.
Anyone?
Is this the only place we have where it refers to open space and a vote for the of the public?
Correct.
I support keeping the open space, adding the words open space in there, but I don't support the water.
Opinion on water, Jerry? Include it. Peggy?
It's fine.
Bruce?
I do want to include it.
It's included. Got it.
So I want to go back to 6 and 7. So if that would pass, this is, and we have this in an election when potentially new council people are elected.
You're talking about 6 and 7?
Well, 6 first.
6, okay. So 6 is already, what we're doing in 6 is eliminating the graph. It already is set by compensation by ordinance. Council sets that by ordinance. And by state law, you cannot give yourself a raise. So if you amended the ordinance to give yourself, to give a raise to future council members, anyone being elected at the next election would fall under that category. Those that didn't would continue to get the old amount. But this is not asking the voters, shall the compensation for council members be set by ordinance? That's already in there. This is part of the issue around having the sample ballot language. What we're doing in this question is eliminating that original graph that's in the charter from when the charter was originally created, because it's not relevant anymore. And so the commission was trying to eliminate that older stuff, and I think Councilman Beckman's got the page up right there, that little graph. So that's all it is getting rid of it. The words on the paper are already allowed by charter.
If everybody else is okay with it, fine. I still am spinning on it. On number 7, I think I suggested this when we talked about it before, changing the term finance director to chief financial officer, so that if we ever change the title, we don't have a conflict with the charter. It's just a friendly thing to be more flexible.
Okay. Yeah, we can certainly work that into the final ballot language.
No.
No.
We had a discussion as council about that, and
did you?
We
Ooh, jumped
came down in favor of finance director. So unless we want to change that whole decision.
Sorry, I don't recall that conversation. That was during the study session?
Okay.
I think part of the discussion was just parallel structure, you know, what your titles were at that level.
Make them fit.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
The only thing I like about, if I may, going back to Section 21, the salaries, the chart, is that some folks don't know what we get paid, and some folks may think we get paid a lot. That's the only reason I can see leaving it in there. And if it were to change anyway, it still changes, has to go to a vote.
No. So in the original charter, they set out what the starting pay was going to be, and then the language in the existing charter says council may, through an ordinance, amend it. So there is an ordinance on the books that's not in the charter but is in your legislative action that says what the current salaries for the council are. So you wouldn't go to the charter to see what your salaries are.
Ordinance 26, 2005.
So the ordinance, going then if you went back to the ordinance, it would show the graph still?
It has the current number of
whatever the current number
yeah,
is.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And always will, and it's probably been changed multiple times.
Are able to get to it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's just ordinance, not charter. Yep.
Okay.
So, I'm sorry, for clarity, on 7, we're keeping finance director there based upon the council.
Prior discussion.
Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. All right. So, we had stopped at 11, moved down to 15, unless there's anything between 11 and 15.
What I do on 12, let's see.
Yes, sir.
It just seemed, now, the wording on the handout is the wording in the charter, is that?
Yes.
Yeah, so the current wording is all of it, and then if it's red, that's what's being changed.
The proposed stuff. Mm-hmm. I guess my only comment on it is that that is such a crazy looking two sentences. If there were a better way to put it, boy, I sure want to do it.
Yeah, well, and again, the ballot language that's ultimately crafted will look different than what we...
This is just perhaps
type thing.
That was,
yeah, I'm okay with that. Yeah. I'm just saying when you go back to the charter, just even the way it's just worded itself, is just, it would have been great if they could have reworded it somehow.
Yes, the problem is anything we change, a comma has to go to the
right
voters. And so
no, I'm not looking to change
charter.
It. Gosh, when
yep.
you read that thing, it's two sentences and it's
yep.
or three sentences. It's just loaded.
That particular
understand. It's probably written by an attorney.
That particular section is just removing the requirement for an additional public hearing if you amend the budget by more than 5%. So you're good with that?
I am.
Okay. So on 15. Oh.
So.
Yes. I don't.
Go ahead.
Quick question for you on 14. I assume this language is part of Tabor, but it talks about it redlined out assessed valuation of taxable property and put in statutory actual value. So is that Tabor phraseology for the same thing, I assume? I guess I was going to ask, what exactly is a statutory actual value?
That is
that was a recommendation
89.
Of our bond counsel,
yep.
and so I'd have to go back and look at his memorandum on that.
So you guys are fairly comfortable it's doing what it's supposed to be doing, whatever it means.
Yeah, we had a separate review at the request of the Charter Review Committee to evaluate, have bond counsel give us recommendations.
That's fine.
You might have enjoyed that presentation. The rest of us nodded and said, sounds good.
So
I don't think this was the first time they had reviewed charters against
sounds right.
Tabor.
Yeah, it sounds right.
So I'm sorry, I wanted to back up to number 9. I think that should be in consultation with the council and not just with the city manager. Because I think that's an
important point. One more time,
please. In number 9, I think that should be in consultation with the council and not just with the mayor. I can't see we'd get into a great conflict, but I think it's a council kind of decision.
I agree to that, yeah.
So the only thing I would say, and I don't distinctly remember the conversation by the Charter Commission, but I think there is a logistical issue, given that we cannot have executive session, that there may be some circumstances where the reason for hiring legal counsel has potential ramifications in a public forum of whether or not that who and why you're hiring that person. And, you know, I don't know what a specific example may be, but if there's a pending lawsuit that needs specialized legal advice, having that discussion, we cannot go into executive session until we have a court case with a court number and all, and most likely we'd be hiring special counsel early on in that process. And so the logistics of having that conversation with the counsel could put us at risk in our ability to defend if we have to have that conversation in the public forum. So
but would we have to refer to the specifics of a case to just authorize hiring counsel?
Well, in order to let you guys know what the issues are, why we're hiring the special counsel, I guess I could raise a question of what does in consultation with the city council mean? Does that mean you guys have to take a vote? I think there's part of the, I mean, what I do recall from the conversation, and Wendy or Kristen can jump in, was that there was some thought that there should be more than one set of eyes that looks at the hiring of special counsel, and the thought of having the administrative CEO, the city attorney, and then the head of the council, the mayor, that was sufficient for making a decision about what we need to hire, or who we need to hire, if it's a person in that. I see conflict and challenges if we had to bring it to the full body of the council.
But haven't we authorized publicly a sort of global funding for special counsel?
Well, yeah. I mean, if it's within the budget, it's
God. Oh, should we
celebrate?
Never mind, I lost it.
So I think the thought here was, again, that the that having the city attorney on their own make the decision was may not be the best way to go. And so adding two sets of eyes, the heads of each one. And again, this is charter amendments, not legislative action. And so the council and the future councils could say, we're not going to fund additional council. We're just going to fund what's within the city attorney's office, and you need to come to us for any additional funding in some fashion. And so there will always be the control of the council through the budgetary process. But I do, to repeat myself a little bit, this having to have an explanation for purposes of hiring special counsel that could put the public dollar at risk, I think is, you know, it's could be questionable about whether that's something that you want in the charter. You can always pass additional ordinances or legislative processes that restricts or enhances the mayor's role.
The committee supported it with the addition of and mayor. Majority. There was no minority.
I support it. I think it's actually something that we do need to be conscientious of, and without having the privilege of exec sessions, because that's this is exactly why exec sessions are important to community and to its leadership body. Without that privilege, we do need to find other ways in order to be able to protect the community. And I think that we have, you know, if you have trust and confidence in your city attorney to make the proper recommendation with appropriate backup and background and necessary justification, then the city manager and the mayor can be a checkpoint on that. And if there's agreement, then I'm okay with those three positions fleshing out the value of the need for that or permission for that. And I agree with Michael that, you know, on the budget, that's something we'll see. And if it's, you know, running high, and, you know, then those are things we can question in a public session in more general term in terms of the budget. But I don't have a problem with it.
Okay.
Okay.
We're okay.
Can I ask a different question on the same?
Sure.
And this is for the city attorney. Can council hire special counsel? Can city council hire a special counsel without doing it through the attorney?
Yes, and I think you guys have. Yep. I think you have.
That's why I'm asking, because we have, but mm-hmm. So we haven't really changed anything with right. This wording. Okay.
So, but it doesn't say we can, or does it? In what we're doing.
So we're not prohibited from it.
No, but the point is, if we can and it's not in the charter, why do we need this in the charter?
I think
part of the original conversation is there has been discussion between the council and the city attorney on who can hire additional counsel. And the old language that was in there, I just... to take charge of any litigation or to assist the city attorney, the council may also employ other counsel whose compensation, et cetera. And there had been historically some question of, does that mean that the city attorney on their own can hire it? And so as we worked with the Charter Commission, we believe the intent was, and certainly from the Charter Commission, that the city attorney should be able to hire additional counsel to support the council. And then there was conversation of should that happen essentially in a vacuum, a little bit to Councilman Brinkman's comment. You could modify it just to say the city attorney without consultation with the manager or the mayor may also employ it, because that person works at your discretion and if they make decisions that you don't support. But the original conversation was really around clarification of who can make that decision and can the city attorney on their own make that decision, which we fully support. The Charter Commission thought it would be good to have some checks and balance by having the manager and the mayor as part of that review.
And four council people could still come forward and say, no, we're not.
Certainly.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, you can control the budget.
Say, Phil, where y'all approved it, and four of us said, no, we're not going to do this. So we still have that ability.
So I'm not, I don't have the charter memorized. Someplace.
You don't?
No, geez. Forgive me. So I thought I remember in here a statement that council can provide additional staff for the city attorney. And if that's so, wouldn't that be covered?
Well, that's what we're changing is the section here, because it may also employ other counsel.
No, well, just a second then. So let me find.
Page 6 on the.
Yeah, just. Where you're looking is not
where I'm
looking.
It's at the very top. The number's not there. It's section 57, which is on the previous page, but it's at the top.
Okay, gotcha.
Page 6.
So why doesn't that cover this?
Again, I think the issue there was we were originally looking for clarification based on past disagreements between the counsel and the attorney on who made the decision around employing additional counsel, because the old language said this counsel may also employ other counsel, this, meaning the city council may also employ other counsel. And so the ask of the Charter Commission was to allow the city attorney on their own with appropriate budgetary allocation appropriation to hire additional counsel, and they thought that that made sense, but also said we want these additional set of eyes. So that's where the in consultation with came from.
These two seem to be a little bit of tug of war to me, so So I don't really support this one, but I'm in the minority.
Anyone else have issues?
No.
All right.
I do have one question on that same page 6, 59.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's striking the words, all contracts in writing, binding. Why are those words removed?
So right now, all contracts are required to be signed by the mayor. And so this removes that requirement that all contracts be signed by the mayor, and leaves it to all conveyances of an interest in land by the city shall be signed by the mayor. And moves it, it still has to be, it'll be signed primarily by, I mean, either by the mayor or by myself as city manager with review and approval through the city attorney's office, and again, through our normal bidding process.
That's number 10.
All right, jumping back to 15, unless there's anything else. Okay, so in 15, there was, 15 is section 83, and it's a fairly long section. There was unanimous support except for two sections, and that is in J, actually, I guess they're both in J, and that is where it says in a legal newspaper. And so the issue here was around publishing. And so it had said, for example, and shall publish monthly all disbursements of $500 or over in a legal newspaper. And so we had conversation with the commission about that dollar amount. Doug Farman was recommending that that dollar amount be raised. We don't do a whole lot of under $500. And the commission thought that keeping that dollar amount was valid, but did support with dissenting opinion, removing the in a legal newspaper. And so that would be published online and in other locations as approved by the council through the city clerk's recommendations on an annual basis.
Let's keep in mind, too, that they're not published out of the goodness of the heart. We pay for
that is correct.
Legal notices.
Yep.
So it's the, financial.
So the rest of the changes in 83 were not did not have a descending appendage. It was just those two in a legal newspaper piece.
Questions?
Okay. And the rest were unanimously supported. So unless there are questions between number 16 and number 30, I'd be happy to take any questions on that. But other than that, yes, sir.
On section 21, that's page 14.
21. Okay. Hold on a sec.
14.
Mm-hmm. Four. Or section 104 of the charter.
Sir, what section?
100.
100. Yes, sir. I do.
But what was their mindset behind that?
So most of the finance section in the charter, Doug had recommendations around, or the bond council, about removing it from the charter and putting it into ordinance. And so the council would set the bidding process for capital improvements, et cetera, through to go to Councilman Stallman's, through being elected representatives and making the decision over time of how the bidding process should occur, as opposed to having it in your charter and locking in numbers like $5,000. At the time, in 1979, $5,000 had X value. In 2015, we don't do much for under $5,000. And so shifting that authority to the city council and allowing them through ordinance to make those decisions was thought to be an appropriate action in representative government by the charter and recommended by finance director. So it's good to keep in mind that all of these, it's not eliminating the bidding process, it's shifting it from charter to ordinance.
And I have a follow-up on that, then, if I may. So, and I'm thinking of when we were doing that agreement with Inglewood to do this study for fire services, and we didn't receive the justification why. It was very weak and very poor. Did any of this change that type of contract?
No, not unless council changes the bidding process, because right now,
and
so
there was no bid, and there was no single source until given to us afterwards.
So services don't require bids. We can sole source on bids. It's construction projects that require the bidding process and sole source. Because this was a consultant,
right,
which is services, and really, I think the reason, and that's pretty universally held for municipalities, and I think the reason is that services are a lot about the relationship. It's not about low bid. It's about who are the players in there. As the two of you just participated in the streetscape plan, you're looking at the individual. Who's the principal in this one? Who's the architect for this particular piece? Who's going to be doing
civil? I think you
answered
my question, though.
Okay.
It doesn't change anything.
Sorry, Jerry. Forgot it was short and sweet. Come on, I was just getting warmed up.
I know you were.
I've got one other person.
Can you help me understand the context of number 16?
Can we, before we go to another one, can I make a comment?
Bond Council.
Sure. Okay. On the, so my question is, when we're looking to take something that is currently in the charter and essentially replace it by something in ordinance, this isn't a question that necessarily needs to be answered now, but how do we communicate to folks what we've just had as part of our discussion around the table that, indeed, we aren't saying, hey, we don't have a bid process. What we're saying is we're moving the bid process from charter to ordinance. And how do we make sure that we communicate that so we're not, like, all of a sudden we're abandoning setting forth standards. We're going to actually displace them by something that's not in fixed language that's in the charter, or less flexible language in the charter, with something that's more current or easily dealt with that's in ordinance.
Want to answer?
Well, no, I guess what I was going to sort of follow on with, I mean, this, I actually, you're sort of going to a point generally with this that I was sort of noodling on.
Yeah,
it's the same thing.
I said it doesn't have to be answered now because there is a general question about all of
this. Well, the communication, but I mean, is there going to be like a blue book or something that follows on with this?
So I think we have to be cautious on the blue book in terms of how we handle this versus other things. Blue books are for Tabor, required for Tabor items. I think what we'd do, just to jump in and somewhat answer the question tonight, is we would probably use the Littleton Report and do an explanation of the process, the appointment of the Charter Commission, what they went through, and then hit the highlights of what these what these 30 questions ultimately are and explain, to the mayor's point, it's not elimination of bidding requirements. It's shifting from A to B on the city manager appointments. It would be explaining, you know, the rationale for that, and use it through more of an explanation, because one of the challenges we're going to have, we being Kristen, will be development of the ballot language, because the counties are not going to allow us to provide the red line equivalency.
Right.
It's just going to have to be a ballot question that in its totality explains this. And so in order to, and I mean, as you guys have seen, these are, for the most part, non-controversial, but yet they have words like taxes and
right.
condemnation. Yeah. I mean, they have words in them that are, that can garner some of that concern. And so utilizing the Littleton Report and some other information prior to you adopting the ordinance.
Based on the seminar you and Deb went to, I mean, do you think that's going to be the right approach here?
There's going to be, and I'll let Deb step in on this, but there's going to be points that we're going to want to make sure we address in the communication that outline that and taking a look at the process we're following through all of that, but to make sure that, indeed, there's a problem statement that impacts or constrains some of the flexibility or reality that exists, and to say, here's what we're looking at. And what it does is it impacts and it makes some of the processes more complicated, or it has language in it that just doesn't work.
I think the key will be to get the information, kind of even a question and answer to the community multiple times in multiple ways, so that they have, it's not a sales job, it's an informational job, which is our job.
And this is targeted for 16, is that what I understood, or 15?
No, November of 15.
So, I mean, time then becomes exceedingly short.
The hope is that we can convey the issues around this relatively easily. We're not anticipating that these items are going to have opposition in the public. We were thoughtful about that as we deliberated what to bring forward to you. So the idea is that these are, Kristen doesn't always like this terminology, but I think of these as primarily administrative cleanup things. That's why I stressed, aside from those two, these were universally recommended, unanimously rather, by your Charter Commission, who spent, you know, hours and hours looking at this. And these are items where they have, there were other ones where they are controversial, and we felt like that was probably not appropriate right now, given kind of the overall, you know, issues that we've been dealing with in the community. So these are ones that the council had said, yes, we support, and the Charter Commission said, yes, we support, again, up to paragraph 60 at least. So the thought is there needs to be some explanation, but it's not a, it won't be contentious.
Okay.
And if that changes on a couple of them, we can regroup prior to you adopting the final ballot.
And part of this is, you know, we did commission the commission as our group. They had an opportunity not only to discuss it among themselves, but to gather input. And these are essentially, these are all the unanimous items that are there, and except for the two we've discussed, they were nearly unanimous.
Yes.
So that's my words.
No, I understand.
So
16. I guess I heard what you said about bond council, but I guess my concern here, it flat out says the city may issue revenue bonds, but since we never detabored, technically we're not able to do that without a vote. So is there some other reference in here to the fact that we can issue revenue bonds assuming
approval of the voters?
Yeah, the citizens approve the issuance thereof. I mean, this one seems a little bit, the word plenary basically says we can pretty much do whatever we want, but I'm not sure that's entirely accurate.
So 89, and Kristen can jump here, but 89 refers to general obligation bonds, I don't know if there's a difference between revenue bonds. I would think that that affects enterprise funds, which aren't subject to Tabor. I'm looking at Kristen. Does that
We're jumping around here. I thought we were talking about Section 90.
We were.
Okay. And so it shouldn't, you know, again, I was just trying to group these. It probably shouldn't say plenary authority. It's more plenary authority. And this was a general recommendation by bond counsel that that there's, you know, clear statutory authority for many types of revenue bonds. But, you know, that he wanted to make sure that there are some limited cases where there's not general statutory authority for all types of revenue. And so he just wanted to leave that door open. And he also noted, he said, so expanding the revenue bond authorization beyond the authority conferred by statute would also facilitate the ability of the city to establish less common enterprises.
I think it will always be in an enterprise fund that you would have a revenue bond.
So, I mean, I don't know. Yeah, I hear what you're saying. That one sentence is not particularly easily interpreted. So, I mean, I guess I could see this one, people having an awful lot of heartburn with this because until you said enterprise fund, I get we could do that for the sewer plant in theory. And we probably will have to. But I don't know. I mean, what you guys redlined out says now or hereafter provided by statutes of the state of Colorado for municipalities of every class. I'm not sure. I guess I'm sort of thinking at some level maybe this is almost avoiding a whacking of the hornets. I guess if they didn't, the voters didn't approve this, they'd go back to what was in there, and then you're not really any worse off. But why even ask the question? If it's a loaded question, and what we've got in there doesn't seem to be really that innocuous.
Yeah, it's
for our community.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Did they understand that we hadn't detabored the way most every other community had done? Bond council.
Yes.
They were apprised.
Yes.
Yeah, and I don't think this is as much a Tabor issue as, again, it's an enterprise fund issue. And
we're going to have to be real clear on what we're talking about. Because people don't understand what that means.
So to your point, agreed. But to your point, I think they were looking at it from the giving broadest authority. We don't have many enterprise funds, and I'd be surprised in our community if we really expanded out into that capacity. So it may be one that you guys want to just take off the books and say it's worth leaving it in there because the limitation within the statute isn't.
We've been operating under. I mean,
no
heartburn if this feels like it's too complicated to convey, and we've got enough.
Well, the danger with it is, I guess, speaking plainly. I mean, if we stick something like this in here, and people see that, then they just. Is it yet again the kind of thing where people say, well, they're trying to do something to stick one over? And obviously that's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to do cleanup. But if they see this, do they basically then just say, bang it, bag the whole thing, I'm going to vote no on everything?
Yeah, and sort of see that happening.
Yeah, it sort of defeats the purpose of what we're trying to accomplish. I guess I'd feel better just taking that one out because it just seems like a live hand grenade, if you ask me.
You, Jerry, others?
I'm agreeing.
Look, you're down to 29.
I have a question about, are certificates of participation bonds?
Bonds?
Are they?
Bonds. Because that is a real sticking.
No.
You know, we don't want to.
No,
they're not considered.
It's a lease back.
If that discussion got into this, it would kill us. Because there's such a distrust for them.
Which is unfortunate because it's a very common funding mechanism.
Just telling you, a lot of the communities.
No, they're not.
So which ones are we taking out?
Number 16.
Which is 81 and 89.
All right, other questions on the charter before we hand it over to the city attorney?
20. 9 or 90.
Well, you know what, I have an old sheet.
20, which is on page 50 in the handout, 103, section 103.
What is the thought for removing that?
So right now it's limited to, hold on, let me get to it here, 2 years. No contract for service shall be made for the city for a period longer than 2 years unless authorized by an ordinance that shall not be an emergency ordinance. And so allowing the council and or the manager to enter into a contract for longer than 2 years, I feel like that was limiting. This was, I believe, another finance department request.
Right, so we're finding that we're frequently negotiating contracts for two-year contracts, and I think our department directors are not getting the competitive bidding if we were able to enter into longer-term contracts without having to come to council through an ordinance.
And an ordinance for a contract is fairly...
What kind of contracts are we talking?
It's any sort of service contract. So actually where we're seeing this the most is with software as services, when we're getting IT services. They want to have, you know, ongoing contracts that continually renew, and we can't do that. And so we are negotiating every piece of technology down to 2 years.
Yeah. And it ranges from that. I was going to also, you know,
cleaning services,
you know, for the buildings. So it ranges the gamut that we're seeing.
This one actually moves us in a tighter fiduciary environment, which allows us more flexibility as the contractee, I guess, on this.
Peggy, you had one?
Yeah, on the revocable permits, number 27. I have a problem with that if we don't have some kind of guidance with that for ensuring equity, safety, etc. I mean, just allowing that without something included.
Well, again, think about charter versus ordinance.
Yeah.
So this is charter language, and so this would grant the city council authority, which is what you currently have, and that's a conversation we've been having, under what conditions may people place items in the right-of-way and on the sidewalk. And that is currently in 815 now, and so the either clarification, additional language, lesser language, the city council would amend 815 to be reflective of the mood of the council in any given period of time.
So say again, so why do we need it if we're currently doing it?
This says that the council may grant the permits, and so right now,
says the city.
No, that's what we're proposing, is that it says the city may grant, the city being administrative and not the city council. So right now, per charter, we would have to bring it to the city council for a motion or resolution. This would allow the council, through ordinance granting the city manager, city administration authority, limited by whatever you put in 815, to grant those permits.
So
clarification language more than
against our policy.
Correct.
On that, though.
Yep.
So we would still hold the policy, and you would be the executor. I don't want to approve all those permits.
I don't want to have to sign them.
No. Here's the rules. Here's the form. Fill it out and give it to the city manager.
The Charter Commission also added, obviously, clarification on locations.
Okay, so not to get anybody in trouble, but if it currently says council issues these, I mean, does this, how do we have revocable...
You have authorized through ordinance.
All those downtown?
You authorized the public works director to grant them.
Pardon?
In ordinance, you've authorized the public works director to grant them. So he signs all of the revocable permits.
And that action was necessary because of the charter.
So you just want to simplify it, that's the idea?
Correct. And add, add where you can grant permits.
It, then that authority, what's the issue?
To clarify it, simplify it, and also add those other locations within the charter.
So I don't support that one.
All right, thank you very much. We will go to work on... One more.
So real quick, I think we should have a minimum for the Charter Review Committee, at least so many years that that they review, so they could do it more frequently. But I think we should have something, whether it's 3 years, 5 years, whatever.
And so the committee talked a lot about whether you should have times in there. And I think ultimately they did not recommend a amount of time in there because they wanted to leave it up to the council on if there was a concern or a need that it would be at that point and not just do it for the sake of doing it. Because I think when they, from a holistic standpoint, they really tried to look at the charter from a document that had to stand the test of time and would not need to come back and be amended on a regular and ongoing basis. And so they didn't feel that it was necessary to say, okay, in 3 years we need to look at this again. They wanted to leave it up to the elected body to say periodically. And that's, there was a lot of conversation about whether there should be times in here or not, because they talked about every 10 years, every 5 years, et cetera, et cetera. So just, again, as background, whatever the council
periodic
wants.
Periodic says nothing. It could be every 50 years. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that's what's implied by periodic. I
mean, it would be this body in the future that would say, it's time, there's an issue, we want to bring the Charter Review Committee forward. But it's...
I like the wording. I think that restricting it to certain years, you end up putting this group of volunteer citizens together to work on something that may not need their time, effort, and energy. This group put in, I don't know, plus the staff time that was with it, hundreds of hours. So it's enough of a commitment. It's enough of an obligation that I think it's council would be best to be the ones that trigger when that should happen. And again, it's, you know, what was 50 years since we've done it? Is that how long it's been? If ever?
There have been some amendments in between,
but not a whole review of the charter.
Not a comprehensive review, correct.
I mean, the ideal with a charter is that it should be able to stand up for years and years and years without a bunch of changes. So
we didn't have this in current.
Correct. This was a recommendation of, and again, they...
So my view would be then, if we didn't have it in the current one, and we decided there was a need, we did it, then why put this in, which doesn't say diddly squat, because when a council decides they think it needs to be done, they'll do it. And periodic suggests a certain cycle of...
You don't need to add it. You're absolutely correct.
Yeah, so I would not put it in.
That would get you down to 28 questions.
I was going to say, personally, I like it as a recognition that, as opposed to what we had before, which didn't say it should ever be reviewed, to saying, hey, there should be a periodic review, and provides for at least some context for that. And it goes on to say that it should be a commission of not less than 14 electors within the city. It says that there should be a written report that's provided to the council. So it does go beyond just talking about, hey, it should be there. It actually says, hey, and it's listening to the commission that said, hey, this was a goodly number of folks. It meant that there was a diverse set of folks among the city. And I'd rather have it in there than not. And I realize that it's one of those things which can be ignored if so chosen, but it at least specifies some aspects of how the group gets formed and takes a look at it.
So does this, are we thinking we would have a standing committee?
No.
So
if you read it.
No, so then I think the wording needs to be changed to... shall there periodically be established?
I'm not going to argue about the words that are here. I'm worrying about the words that they put together, the commission actually put together, which says, shall be appointed by the council.
I'm okay with where it is.
Okay. We're good.
Okay. Thank you, council.
Okay.
Agenda item two.
Agenda item two. I'll turn it over to Councilmember Franklin.
Well, I had asked staff to work on getting us some information regarding a look at our current smoking ordinance and looking at some ways that we can. I think there's a couple problems with smoking, public smoking anymore. One of them is that whatever that law is, I've heard 25 feet, 15 feet in front of doors, it's not working for the most part in a lot of places, particularly if you look at Main Street. You have a lot of people standing outside the front doors, and you've still got to walk through. The public still has to walk through the smoking to get in. I don't think that was the intention of the law. So what are we doing? I think we're following state law. I'm not sure we came up with anything on our own. Is there something we should do differently? We do have some unique situations. The other part of that was concerning smoking in some of the public places, for example, playgrounds, where you would tend to have more of a population that would not, you would not want to have in the environs of smoke. I've had a number, I don't know if anybody else in council has, but I've actually, over the last few months, I've had a number of citizens call regarding that, that they have, they want to know what is the rule, what's the law about smoke on playgrounds, and, you know, parks and open space. You know, just kind of public spaces. I'm not talking about private properties. That's that gig. But I had enough people say stuff to me, and I've also felt as though, you know, we probably at the very least ought to look at what we're doing and look at what others are doing and see if there's a way we can do something that maybe serves the greater population. And also, what do they call it?
Vapes.
Vapes. There's a lot of cities that are starting to have to deal with that. A lot of this is really generated by citizen complaints. So I think it's just a good time to look at it. We've got a lot of new restaurants and bars and business coming into downtown. That tends to be where we have the smoking going on. And then, you know, the whole thing, the whole issue with the playgrounds was putting a lot of money into new playgrounds and applying for grants to redo existing playgrounds and structures and parks and stuff. So just thought it was a good idea to take a look at what we could do to improve it, and then also what's the practical reality for enforcement on some of that.
So we do have a no smoking ordinance. Looking to see when, it looks like you guys adopted it in 2014, and it's in Chapter 10 of Title 6, and it's basically adopts sort of the minimum.
So what good, the state?
So it's 15 feet from entryways, and then it's indoors public spaces. So restaurants, bars, courtrooms, public buildings, theaters, museums. So it doesn't address sort of these outdoor public areas like playgrounds or parks. I think Debbie and I talked a little bit, too, about like light rail platforms, things like that. So those are certainly areas where we could expand. If you're interested, and it doesn't include the electronic cigarettes, so we could include those as well.
I think we have to look at the downtown, and if somebody's in front of someone else's, if someone's in front of their door, how's that 15 feet affect the next door? I mean, it kind of creates a whole.
It could create almost a whole block if you had enough doors, right, you know, in a downtown area. It definitely could end up creating a whole block where it's non-smoking.
And that's effectively how Boulder got to their position, which is by the time they measured 15 feet radiuses, unless somebody was standing into a little triangle on their mall, and so they just got to an enforcement position that basically said no.
Well, I guess that's the issue, is that if we are kind of at that place, it's definitely not being enforced. So Do we start enforcing it, or do we do something different? Do we make it 25 feet? I don't know.
Is it enforceable?
I think it's a reactionary thing. It's a phone call, not a drive-by.
Yeah. And it's, I'd rather have the comfort, I mean, we can take a more proactive approach on enforcement, but I think that the question here is, do you want to expand?
Right, no, I understand.
Expand the issue out, and if so, then, you know, we'll address enforcement appropriately. You know, some of this is, and I apologize, I had to step out, the, you know, the patios. We've got Platte River that uses private patio. There's actually lots of businesses in Littleton that use patios on private property. Do you want to prohibit smoking in outdoor public or private patios? For eating establishments, you've got the tavern with its rooftop ones. You've got, I think, Old Chicago has an outdoor patio. I mean, most restaurants have outdoor patios that are not on the public right-of-way. Downtown is an issue, and as Debbie brought up, you've got lots of public playgrounds, you've got light rail station. So where do you want to go with smoking prohibition?
So at least some of my thoughts, putting them out there, would be for those establishments whose patios don't infringe on other public right-of-ways, and I can think of several that have essentially set that for their patrons that do smoke. I think they have the ability to. Establish a private patio that's private, but outdoors. I've heard enough from parents of young children that are in playgrounds that, at least considering playgrounds. I'm not sure how you define the spaces, so I would kind of leave that up to staff to kind of take a look at, is how well can you establish that basically says that's there. I'm not as familiar with vapes, but I know that folks have considered vapes to essentially be the same as what smoking. If that's appropriate or not, I'd like to see maybe a little bit of study that goes into that, say inclusion or exclusion of vapes, and I'm not even sure if that's the right word, but vapes. How does that work? I would be inclined to include them, but at least from that particular perspective. But that's some of my thinking that says there. Whether it's all outdoor spaces or like someone that's walking along the Greenway or something like that. I'm not as emotionally tied to something like that. I haven't had anyone necessarily complain about that, but I certainly wouldn't want to see cigarette butts along the Greenway, but that's... Thoughts? Bruce?
Not... I think what both of you are saying, I'm not particularly opposed to the public right-of-way. I can see downtown, like to maybe keep it off Main Street. On the other hand, I guess my initial question would end up being is, do we, and maybe the answer is it's not applicable, because if Boulder's done it on their mall, and that's a relatively popular place, do we kind of think there wouldn't be really any impact in terms of the number of patrons that are frequenting our downtown area? I mean, I don't know how we could necessarily try to gauge that. I mean, if we thought we were going to enforce or enact a no-smoking ban on Main Street, do we think we'd see some reduction in patrons as a result of that? I have no idea. I think that'd be an interesting thing to consider, because if somebody concluded that it was going to push a lot of patrons away, I think we might have to consider the implications. But playgrounds, to me, I'm fine with saying no smoking on playgrounds or school property or that kind of thing. And then some of the open space things, I mean, I guess I kind of, sort of what Phil said, I don't have a problem if somebody wants to have a, you know, it'd be nice if they'd use a receptacle if they're on the Mary Carter or something, but on the other hand, I you know, generally would probably want to see.
Imagine we do have a litter ordinance.
Yeah, well, there you go, yeah. Again, sort of the other conversation, but, you know, I don't have major heartburn over saying, you know, we don't want to see smoking in open space in general, and I think that's, you know, not an unreasonable outcome, because the whole point of open space is to promote health and recreation and so forth and so on, which seems to be counterintuitive relative to smoking.
This is going to be a highly charged issue no matter what we do with it, and it seems to target the downtown again, which is a sensitive area of Littleton, but the reason that it does is if we're talking about public roads, sidewalks, and public space, it's the most compacted into an area in those square blocks of downtown Littleton. It doesn't make much impact as you move farther up the down Santa Fe or farther up the boulevard. So I think this is what Boulder was dealing with, that they decided to make it a district, and, you know, rather than, you know.
They basically got to a mapping that started to say if you measure 15 feet away from every roadway, by the time that you went to what would be kind of an allowable space 15 feet away from the doorways, it was pretty small areas.
I was in Pueblo a couple weeks ago, and it was interesting. They have an older part of town with different kinds of shops, and one of the shops is a vape shop, and you could find it pretty easily because it was the only shop that didn't have the sign in the window that said no vapes allowed, and it was creating a real conflict down there because a vape instrument doesn't necessarily put out an odor unless it's flavored or designed to. It could be designed not to also and just be a means of ingesting nicotine. But what happens is the vape shop has flavors. Looks like a spice shop, you know, kind of thing. And so that is the next thing that's going to be happening if we can look at others. And just the other comment was, you know, you could say, well, Boulder does that because Boulder's this way or that. New Orleans just did it also for the entire area of their downtown and their entertainment quarters identified. So it's bigger than just being a Boulder issue. And then just finally, the problem with the 15 feet is that's where the cigarettes exhaled. It's not where the smoke goes. And so the complaints that we're getting are where the smoke's going too. And that's part of that problem of trying to limit it in some way because smoke doesn't follow the rules.
I think, Bruce, you had an interesting point about is this going to be a controversial issue? And I would hope it's not. The approach here is not to try to reduce the number of patrons. It's more to make a more pleasant experience for everyone. And I think that if you look at, you know, you've got Merle's and you've got Tavern, they have private property space where they can and have created smoking areas. Tavern in particular has an outdoor space on the right-of-way. And so it's no different if people are sitting there and having cigarettes and someone walks by than someone standing at a door. So, and I think that businesses, you know, we can, I don't know how it works. They have back access, back alleys. Is that something we push that, you know, that because they're going to go somewhere. Where do they go? And is it really, for me, it really is just about the public right-of-way, the public area. And I think the open space, I hadn't thought about it, Bruce, but I kind of like that, is to make it open space and parks. We know that making a law doesn't mean everybody's going to obey the law. But what it does do is it does give law enforcement the opportunity. They now have the they have what they need to enforce it. I know one of the things out of South Platte Park that does become quite an issue. It's certainly not right now, but when we get dry and we don't have any rain and that river's running, you know, down and skinny, and you do have, they have had fires start out there and just started from ashes and that type of thing. And so I think that the rangers at that point, you know, have a little bit more authority than, you know, to be able to stop that behavior before it causes a problem.
If I could just follow up, too, when I looked at what Boulder did, they didn't have any public comment objecting to the ordinance. Then they had a council, unanimous council, approve it, so, which is kind of interesting. And then the other comment is that let me hold off on the other comment.
Jerry?
Yeah, it seems like it would be reasonable to do it on our main street. Then, you know, I don't know how in the heck you draw the boundaries, you know, around that. But I can see that because it is a narrow area, and walking down there, as I often do, you do walk into the smoke thing. As far as the parks and playgrounds, though, I'm not into just controlling people's lives everywhere they go. There are people that smoke. I've never been a smoker and don't want to be a smoker, but there are some people that need to have a cigarette for a lot of reasons. And if they're out taking a walk and a stroll, you know, I would hope not to walk across that smoke. But it just seems like we're trying to control just too much. Again, I can see it on a narrow street where you can't escape it. But when you're outdoors, it dissipates rather quickly.
For staff, I'm going to try and kind of summarize a sentiment, which is I'll refer to it as a downtown district. Restriction is certainly something to be looked at. The aspect of, I'll put it, playgrounds and parks would be taking a look at what's out there and I don't know how we necessarily get public comment or thought, if there's any, to be out. But to gather some of that. And then that parks includes open space, gray line that's out there. But look at playgrounds and parks and see what's out there and what might be done and possibly enforceable. And recognize the one probably has greater sentiment than the second.
Open space?
I said I don't know how to draw the line between parks and open space. The grounds and parks together.
I'd rather just take little bites here and just go for like the main street.
I said that's why.
I think we have to have some of that. I mean, the amount of comments I'm getting from the community regarding trying to enjoy the playground with their kids and having to leave the space because of the smoking that's going on. I think we have to look at that. And I think if by saying parks, it covers South Platte Park.
No, I was just asking about open space because we have properties that we have purchased to our last conversation and designated as open space. So I can walk on there. You want us to include that?
I would take a look at it. You may come up and say, you know, there's some technical issues or items that we need to discuss further with that. But I was trying to separate the two, recognizing you have probably a pretty good direction on the first, looking at the downtown district, and then the second is you may come up with other technical issues or questions around that we may need to discuss further. Reasonable summary.
If they came back as two separate ones, I think it'd be easier to pass one. I can see if they came back as just one. That's what I said. Yes, you are.
Okay. Got it? Okay. Anything else from council's perspective? I trust everyone had a chance to enjoy their wet weekend. And
can I ask a question?
just make him in. And I want to thank those that posthumously or whatever for their service and sacrifice. And that's pretty important for us.
Just real quick, did we have any flooding in town last week?
Not that I was aware of, no.
So we did have flood warnings that were issued.
Yeah, Chatfield was probably the biggest thing we were watching because the floodgates were fully open, but we never got close.
But in terms of coming into the right-of-ways and, like, you know, Long Stern Parkway or Bannock?
Nothing I was made aware of.
Wonderful.
I will say the one part that I am aware of is the Greenway, Mary Carter Greenway on the east side underneath Prince was flooded, but not the west side. So if folks had a path, or they could have gone over Prince as opposed to the underpass.
Other than drainage, probably on Stern work.
Okay. You won't even care anymore. Other than that, thank you, Council, and we're adjourned.